Okay, hello everybody. My name is Graham Smith, and with Rosemary Campbell-Stephens, I am hosting this afternoon's webinar on sex, race and class, curriculum transformation and leadership. We are delighted actually to have more speakers than we advertised. As well as Meena Wood and Anne Palmer, we have contributions from Philip Hynan and Simon Martin and Colin Baxter. We added in because when we looked at who was coming, we thought we've got lots of primary people, but our two speakers have a background, apart from other things, in secondary headship. So we've now got some primary school leaders to talk to you as well. Just to say that, please, I think we've got you unmuted, so you can't mute yourself. We are recording this. We suggest you look at it in active speaker view. We're planning to finish at about 5:15. There'll be an opportunity to ask questions before 5:15, we hope. And if you just type a question in the chat, if we can't answer it this afternoon, we will give you an answer when we send you the link to the recording and anything else that people have seen that they want to have a look at. Okay, over to me, actually, isn't it? Because I'm introducing Meena. So I'm going to stop sharing, because I hope Meena's then going to be able to share things.
Thank you very much.
Can I just say, I mean, I can't remember when I first became aware of Meena, but for a long time, she and Sylvain Wiles, who I hope has joined us in the last few minutes, were the only two people at Ofsted who seemed to understand about diversity. They've got some other allies later on, but they held the thought for a long time. She's since that been a head teacher, which I think is quite a brave thing to do, to go back from Ofsted into school, particularly in such a high profile role. She has written a wonderful book, I have a copy of it, about the secondary curriculum.
It's not allowing me to share.
We're going to get around 15 minutes of Meena's today, but I have to say, I went to the book launch, which was about an hour and a half, and is still up somewhere, I'm sure Meena can tell you where, and there's some lovely little snippets of video from people doing things in schools on there, which I highly recommend. So over to you, Meena.
Yep, as soon as I can share what I want to share. So if you could just let me share.
Check. Yep.
It keeps saying,
yeah. You can share.
Right, okay, thank you. That's great, right. Okay, brilliant. Okay. Right, you've gone off, have you? Right, okay, share screen. That's fine, thank you. It's not allowing me to share. Okay. It's not allowing me to share. Okay, I can everybody see? No, you can't see the screen yet, can you? You can't see it, sorry, hello?
Yes, we can, I can see it.
You can, great, yes. Good, all right. So I was wondering if anybody could see it. Okay, apart from me, brill, thanks. Okay, lovely, great, thank you. Right, okay, so I've used as my title, Transform Curriculum, Greater Equity and Access for All Students, effectively, because cutting across the intersectionality of class, race and gender, sex. I wanted to reimagine schooling. Disrupted schools, we've had disrupted schools, and I'm really hoping this is a massive opportunity now to reimagine schooling. The three key curriculum areas that I would select would be oracy skills, assessment and feedback, and cultural capital. And actually, all three areas would straddle primary and secondary. But I'm going to focus on secondary, as Graham said, that's my specialism, if you like. But I know for a fact that when I talk about oracy skills, that is obviously hugely applicable to primary, but I do believe primary schools do it a lot better than secondary, and something bad happens when children go to secondary, which means that they stop speaking. So let's start with oracy skills. I firmly believe oracy skills and self-expression and active listening skills are actually part of cultural capital, and distinguishes between those students who can use these techniques successfully for learning and those who cannot. Now, to be fair, we cannot control home background, we cannot control, you know, sociolinguistic factors, affective, cognitive factors. We can't control anything in our children, but we do have a potential as schools to transform students' communication skills. And the fact is that now that spoken and listening skills, listening language assessments no longer count towards the GCSE exam, it's actually devalued the importance of speaking and listening across the curriculum. And speaking and listening skills have no longer have that primacy in line with literacy and numeracy. And I do firmly believe, and there is much evidence out there from CBI and various other people, employers and so on, and higher education, that we actually need young people to leave school with persuasive negotiating skills, which are really needed for today's jobs and much more importantly for tomorrow's jobs with the advent of AI and ed tech and so on, technology. Vygotsky, in 1962, stressed the links between language, thought and interaction, arguing that the use of language was key to new ways of thinking. So developing oracy skills and expanding curriculum, expanding vocabulary through the curriculum, then really should be central to the notion of engaging with cultural capital. And I believe that unless we develop and oracy skills within the curriculum, we're creating a glass ceiling for a significant number of our students who are left behind. It's no coincidence, is it, that a third of students who leave at 16 do not gain their level 4 English GCSE. Now, only 2% of those who leave school without a level 4, without this level 4 GCSE, actually go on to further education or training or employment. The rest sadly do not. They become NEETs. So what are we going to do about it? Effectively, we can get students to articulate far more than they actually do when they're in lessons. So students with dyslexia, those with low reading ages, those for whom English is an additional language, spoken skills are key in the learning process. And spoken skills actually facilitate metacognitive skills. So learning takes place, it deepens learning, it furthers learning. The knock-on effect of oracy skills means that if they have a primacy within the curriculum, they encourage creative thinking. And this prepares students for further training and employment. One of the other benefits is shifting students' mindset in acquiring foreign languages. As a former foreign language teacher or French teacher, I know the biggest hurdle I faced was getting out my children in those lessons to speak French. They could write it, they could read it, but my goodness, what it took to get them to string together a few sentences was unbelievable. And that was because they were not used to speaking in English. So I firmly believe that other benefits would be a greater take up in foreign languages, as well as progression to other, into A level, for example. Now, the ESB is an accredited English Speaking Board qualification that has criterion-based oracy assessments, similar to those used in the Assessing Pupil Progress program, which some of you, not many of you, I imagine, would remember from 2008 or 9. It was the old APP National Strategies. This criterion-based oracy assessment is currently used in Estonia and Singapore, and it's emphasised in both countries' curricula. Now, we all know, or we should know, that those countries actually achieve a lot higher than England in terms of outcomes at 16. And so I believe, you know, in Estonia, 25% of each subject, and I mean all the vocational, all the academic subjects, are 25% of that has assessed oracy skills in it, which contributes to the exam. So in a sense, that's a model we could be adopting. And with that would come an opportunity to use teacher, self and peer assessment, already being used in drama lessons and in language teaching. So I have no idea why we can't just use that model in English teaching in across the curriculum. ORSE is a powerful tool, and we do, as I said earlier on, it's a route to social mobility, empowering all students to find their voice to succeed in school and life. And I'm just going to pick a couple of these bullets because you can see that effectively I'm providing more and more evidence here on how ORSE can develop literacy, it can also improve academic outcomes, and it can ensure that students thrive in life beyond school. And most importantly, it starts narrowing gaps between the disadvantaged and non-disadvantaged pupils, because that's the point about ORSE skills. It's a great social leveler. If you start assessing children from their starting points, you can develop their ORSE skills and create a voice for them. The way I see the model developing is that we look in each subject to develop ORSE skills through formative assessments, project-based learning, and so on. Many schools now are using curriculum mapping, and basically within that curriculum mapping, you can always find room for students to do some ORSE. And what are we talking about when we say ORSE? We're talking about being able to describe mathematical processes, for example, how you use algebraic mathematics to in chemistry to look at equations, or how you might look at erosion in geography and talk about climate change in science. So it's very much about developing a conceptual project-based approach to learning where children are then expected to or are encouraged to present their spoken skills through collaboration or independently. And I'm now going to move on to assessment and feedback, which was the second area I felt we could be changing. And I just wanted to pass some figures by you as to why I feel there's a lot of issues around assessment at the moment. We have a very bleak backdrop of permanent fixed term exclusions for the past 13 years. Particular groups are more excluded than others. As I said earlier on, 2% of those who are excluded don't have the maths and English qualifications they need. And half of those are not in education, employment or training. Students have different ways of learning, remembering knowledge, and need a range of skills to access the curriculum. Girls are typically better at examinations than boys, for example, and differences exist between disadvantaged and non-disadvantaged groups. But in this case, what we're looking at, even within the non-disadvantaged groups, if you look at attainment, Chinese, Indian, Black African students generally perform better than Black Caribbean or White British. So there are a number of inequalities going on here. There is a real issue with an absence of equity in the way we're assessing children. And that is a prime issue as to why we're losing so many children. Therefore, I would suggest that what we should be doing is, rather than being teachers who transmit knowledge, we start becoming teachers who are facilitators of skills. And the way we can do that is, rather than focus on closing the gap against the standardized normative assessment, for example, through a knowledge transmission model, by that I mean, you know, you all have to get to a level 4 or a level 5, and then those who don't are actually the ones who fail the system. Let's focus on ongoing formative assessment and use ipsative assessment together with dialogic feedback and develop the skills that students need to understand and apply the knowledge. And by ipsative assessment, I mean we are looking at children's progress, the progress they make against their starting points. And we actually, en route, will measure that progress. So it's against themselves, it's not against other people. Surely that's the fairest way to do that. So a child who has a lower starting point will then make progress and can be rewarded with that progress. And that dialogic feedback will be the catalyst by which they make that progress. And I do firmly believe that if you're going to implement formative assessment, it does become a leveler because it provides students with individual feedback and encourages them to focus on continuous improvements against their previous pieces of work. So knowing in terms of feedback then, as I said earlier on, we're looking at an active interlacing of teaching and learning so that the feedback becomes the thing that triggers all the learning that will resurface in terms of writing and speaking. I'm just going to give one example here, and then I'm going to quickly move on to cultural capital, which is the third area I wanted to talk about. As you can see, an example here is the conceptual thinking, which I wanted to give, and it's really around the interconnectedness of skills cross-curriculum. And another way of developing project-based learning might be using Lego education. We've got to think outside the box, which helps students with autistic spectrum disorders to develop teamwork, expression, problem solving. We must start looking at assessment in a different way if we want to create equity. These are some features of project-based learning. And at the heart of all of this are the big ideas that Dylan William talks about, connectedness of the whole curriculum, trunk and branches, if you will, rather than a disorganized collection of twigs and pine needles. And finally, I think I'll probably only be able to take two areas. I won't have time to go to the last one, but I will just mention synoptic assessment, which I think is the way to go with cross-curricular approaches if you're looking at project-based learning. And then the only other area I was looking at was cultural capital. Rosemary, may I have just 2 minutes more, or am I capped? Just to quickly run through cultural capital.
Fine, Meena, 2 minutes.
Thank you. So cultural capital has to be the one that if we change cultural capital and the way we approach it, we can make a definite difference to these children. And why do we have the cultural capital model we have at the moment? Because of E.D. Hirsch, because he believed that a well-rounded knowledge-led curriculum could impart the needed knowledge to all children, overcoming an inequality of opportunity. And in fact, I believe quite the reverse is happening. So I would suggest that if we're looking at cultural capital, we need to look at appreciation of human creativity and achievement, which is the definition from DfE and Ofsted. So why shouldn't we be promoting Stormzy alongside Schubert, Handel with Hendrix? And it's that sort of, again, thinking outside the box about how we're including relevant and memorable learning for all our children. And on the subject, which has been much talked about, I believe, about how we teach history to our children, I think world history needs to be taught through the lenses of as many heritages as we can, all the heritages that contributed to British society, and we should not be in the business of looking at it uniquely through an English lens. And I've given some examples there, for example, during the Second World War, through other areas as well, I could talk about many examples where we should be bringing that into the history curriculum and into other areas of the curriculum. What I just wanted to say was a friend of mine who's an HMI actually said to me the other day that he was going into a school with 99% of the children were of different heritages. And what was going to happen was that in the spring term, the primary school was teaching Rule Britannia on their curriculum. And so what I would suggest is that really, if you're going to be getting your children to become more aware of their background, their heritages, but most importantly, develop critical literacy, which is part of cultural capital, then you need to be developing those skills for children. And I'll point to Finland, where the Finnish curriculum, they have moved towards cross-curriculum. They've decided that critical thinking skills are threaded across the curriculum, and all children have to have these critical thinking skills, because effectively what they believe is, unless you educate children to be more discerning about the history they're learning, about the art they're learning, even when they look at, for example, algorithms in maths to look at how looking at it critically, then that's the only way you're going to develop true citizens who can actually articulate, sustain well-balanced arguments, and then know how to influence regardless of race, gender, or class. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Meena. Thanks. Fabulous. Lovely to have you joining us from Turkey. It's a truly international affair today.
And I'm joining you home. Yes.
Absolutely. And I'm joining you guys from Jamaica. So that was a beautiful segue, Meena, into the rest of the webinar, where we're going to be focusing on the role of leadership and the role of curriculum in terms of shifting that dial. Meena, will it be possible for us to have your slides to share with participants who are taking part in the call? Is that going to be okay? It'd be fabulous if it is, yes?
Yes, I'll be able to get some of those slides across to you, definitely.
Brilliant, because we'd love to share them.
Yeah.
So we've got some already, there's been some activity in the chat around the issues that you've raised, Meena, and that focus on oracy is very, very important, I think. I was wanting to rush off and get one of my books off my shelf, and it's a book that I received as a prize giving, age 7, at my primary school for verse speaking. And I do remember my school being exceptionally good at working with 95% Black pupil intake back in the 1960s. I'll probably go and find the book later and just show people what I received. And thank God for teachers who actually understood the importance of oracy in terms of learning. You know, this is a great way to introduce our next speaker. So our next speaker is Philip Hynan. He's been a teacher for 15 years now. He's worked at 4 inner city Birmingham primary schools, and he's currently the deputy head teacher at the Harper Bell Seventh-day Adventist School in Birmingham. He's passionate about curriculum delivery. He's absolutely off the hook in terms of curriculum delivery. He's also a chair of governors at an inner city Birmingham school, and he's heavily invested in our young people outside of school in terms of providing opportunities for kids. He's a football coach in Birmingham. When I first met Philip or became aware of his work, the thing that struck me is that, you know, he's one of those gifts that you get from the teacher God. You know, every now and again, the teacher God sends somebody into the profession that you just think, you know what, thank you. He's also a head teacher in waiting. So let me just hand over to Philip Hynan. Enjoy his presentation, because it is going to be off the hook. Thanks, Philip.
Thank you, Rosemary. And thank you for reading out that statement that I wrote. Really good, kind of you. Let me just share my slides. Can you see my slides now, Rosemary?
Yes, we can, Philip.
Real. Okay. Right. I'm conscious that I've got 10 minutes. So I've had to take some stuff out or just speak really fast. So I'm just going to speak as fast as I possibly can. And I've got 10 minutes starting now. Okay. So Harper Bell Primary School is a unique school in the sense that it's the only Seventh-day Adventist local authority school in the country. Almost 100% of our pupils are of African Caribbean heritage. Over half of our children are entitled to free school meals. Pupil stability is through the roof. 200 children at PAN on an average year would have 300, if not more, children pass through our doors. So we're passionate about making sure that the time that our children do have here, we make the most of, and we improve their learning. And the one way we do that is through our curriculum. Right, so I'm going to skip through some of these already. Right, so in terms of Harper Bell, our vision is for all pupils to fulfill their God-given talent and to aspire to achieve a university education. Our values of love, learning, laughter, making sure that our pupils, when they get picked up at the end of the day by their parents, can say that they've been taken care of, they've been loved, that they've learned something. and that they've had fun. But in terms of today's presentation, our curriculum drivers, so our curriculum's underpinned by the faith of our school, the cultural heritage of our families, and the aspirations that we hold for our children to achieve the highest possible standards in learning. So looking at some of the reasons why our curriculum is what it is. So done some research, completely non-scientific research, looked at three different curriculums for three different local education authorities, Isle of Scilly, Lewisham, Leicester, and compared and contrasted them despite their different demographics. The content of their curriculums were very, very similar. So the Isle of Scilly, two schools, the curriculum that you see in front of you is one that I'm sure we're all familiar with in terms of the national curriculum. Looking, Lewisham Primary Schools, just Googled it, chose the first three that come up. Like I said, it's not scientific. There will be other examples out there that are different to this. Only one of the schools had tailored their curriculum to the context of their pupils in terms of African and African Caribbean pupils. So we had one of the schools was teaching about Windrush and the same school teaching about African American inventors. The schools in Leicester that I looked at, one of the schools taught about early Islamic civilizations, and that same school taught about Richard III, and obviously after being dug up under a Leicester car park. So what's influenced our curriculum? So a year ago, pretty much the murder of George Floyd led to renewed calls for the national curriculum to be ripped up and rewritten to reflect multicultural Britain, and to be greater emphasis on being anti-racist. But our motivation went beyond that, and we started working on this curriculum, when I say we, myself and Nigel Oram, the head teacher, 5 years ago when we started at Harper Bell. And one of our biggest motivations behind that was the murder of Stephen Lawrence, which was 1993, the McPherson report in 99, and the recommendations made in that report based on the judgments about the failure of the national curriculum and the recommendations to rewrite the national curriculum and to make amendments to it aimed at valuing cultural diversity and preventing racism. But I would argue that in 2021, we're no nearer achieving that recommendation. Some of the things that influenced our curriculum, the statistics that are out there. Only yesterday there was a report in the Guardian newspaper about African Caribbean pupils being 5 or 6 times more likely to be excluded than white pupils in some parts of the country. I would argue it was a slow news day, because that's basically the same story that gets rehashed year after year, but nothing seems to change. Data that's out there, you're more likely as a Black Caribbean pupil to get a fixed term exclusion than you are to get 3 A's at A level. White pupils are pretty much three times more likely to get 3 A's grades or better at A levels than Black Caribbean pupils. So this data is for Birmingham. So I'm a Brummie, as you can probably tell from my accent, which doesn't do very well over Zoom. But anyway, Birmingham data, attainment data. As a local authority, Birmingham divides pupils into 22 groups based on their ethnicity. So white, British, white, European, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, Chinese, and so on. So these are the groups that include Black pupils. On the far left-hand side, you can see where the pupils rank at the end of reception. So 1 year into their formal education, and then on the far right-hand side, where they are when they get to the age of 16. So if you take Black Caribbean pupils, they rank third after 1 year of education, yet by the time they get to 16, they're 21st out of 22. The only group of pupils beneath them in terms of the ranking are Romani Gypsy. Okay, and that picture is replicated for different groups of Black pupils other than white and Black African. So we recognize that things have to change. So what have we done? Local authority school, we've made the national curriculum work for us. And for me, I believe this is key. There is room for maneuver in the national curriculum. So here's a few examples of what we've done in terms of tailoring the national curriculum to work for us. So key stage 2 history, about teaching a significant event in British history post 1066. Lots of schools teach the Victorians, nothing wrong with that whatsoever. We teach the Windrush generation and the impact that the Windrush generation has had on the shaping of Birmingham and Britain as a whole. Everything from learning about different legislations to key events, from Notting Hill riots of 58, the Notting Hill Carnival that came out, that's 2018, Windrush scandal, and so on. Ancient civilizations, okay? Most schools will teach about ancient Egypt, and we teach about ancient Egypt, but we do it through the lens of the Kingdom of Kush. And we teach about the 25th dynasty, known as the Black Pharaohs, who ruled over Egypt for the best part of a century, King Pi. We also teach our children about the ancient African civilizations of Great Zimbabwe, Kush, Carthage, Mali, about the inspirational leaders such as Askia Mohammed and Mansa Musa. We teach our children about how Mansa Musa, the richest man in history, crashed the Egyptian economy on his pilgrimage to Mecca. We teach our children that despite what Google Images will tell you when you search Hannibal Barca, he was not a white European man. But we move on. So geography, key stage one, geography. What else did we do here? So contrasting non-European countries. So we teach our children about the geography of the Caribbean, which I know isn't a country, but we then focus on different islands and different countries. So here's our humanities curriculum. What other stuff I've done there? Everything from Mary Seacole, Ruby Bridges, civil rights in terms of the Bristol bus boycott, the Windrush generation, African civilizations, as I've already touched on, World War One. Okay, so there's a great starting point, I think, for any school out there looking to, wondering where they should start. So we teach our pupils, year six are currently learning about World War One and the contribution of the countries of what was then the empire. So 1.5 million soldiers from India, which was obviously Pakistani, included Pakistan and Bangladesh, Muslim Sikh Hindu soldiers. We teach our children about the Askari soldiers of Africa. We teach our pupils that the first bullet fired by a British soldier was fired by a man called Alhaji Grunshi in Togoland. We teach our pupils about the contribution of the British West Indies Regiment, and so on. And there's loads there, but I'm conscious that I've got 10 minutes. So here are some of the things that we teach our pupils, including history, geography, art. Top right hand corner, our year five and six pupils have a whole unit, a whole term. Their first term is on, their topic is debating and oracy, where they're taught about how to debate and in terms of making rebuttals and points of interest and all that. But the topic for which their debate is on this year was statues to Britain's imperialist past to remove or to revere. So obviously on the back of the statue of Edward Colston being thrown into Bristol Harbour. So our pupils learn all about the transatlantic slave trade and everything linked to that. And then at the end, apply that to what they've been taught about oracy and debating. The book that we're reading, I'll touch on this a bit further down, reflect the reality of our pupils. And our curriculum goes beyond that in terms of policies to do with hair, in that we don't really have one. It's your hair, you wear your hair how you want, you will not be penalized for a certain hairstyle, and so on. There's loads more that I could go into, but I've only got 10 minutes. So when planning the knowledge that we teach our children, we focused on the themes that you see on the left-hand side, and these themes run throughout different subjects and across all year groups, and the knowledge is prescribed and gets progressively more challenging, more difficult as you move from reception to year six. So here's an example here of historical themes. So you can see empire and imperialism running through key stage two, cultural change running through all of the topics we teach. Come back to the skills that we're teaching. This is just history as an example, but I've got this for other subjects, whether it be geography, art, and so on. So empathy, being able to empathize with those who have come before us. And you see that running throughout the curriculum. Migration, here's an example of how the theme of migration, which is one of those golden threads in our curriculum, runs across the whole school from early years who learn about family history, right through to year six, as I've just touched on in terms of World War One and the contribution of the empire. Imperialism, so here's an example of how the golden thread of imperialism runs across a year group as opposed to the school. And you can see in different subjects, from learning about the Berlin Conference of the late 19th century and the scramble for Africa by European imperialists, in English, learning about transatlantic slave trade. Children have just finished a book called Freedom by Catherine Johnson. They're now reading a book of hers at home called Queen of Freedom about Nanny of the Maroons, statue debate I've touched on, I'll move on. So what we have done is design our own pupil workbooks for all subjects from science, geography, history, obviously debate in Latin and in English. And these books contain the knowledge that we want our pupils to learn. They contain the assessment and retrieval activities that we want our children to do. The reason for this was 4 or 5 years ago when we started introducing this curriculum, we recognized that we needed to support our staff in their subject knowledge. So we designed these books to include the knowledge that we are going to teach our pupils. Teachers, with all due respect, come and go. And at Harper Bell, we've had a turbulent few years and teachers were coming and going, but we wanted the curriculum to stay the same and not be limited by teachers' subject knowledge. So lots of time has now been invested into teaching the teachers what they're going to teach the children. So I'll move on from this. These are just more examples. So the books that we read. So the CLPE research called Reflecting Realities, I'm sure you're familiar with. So in 2017, only 1% of books published aimed at primary school pupils had a BAME protagonist. We should be thankful, according to some, because in 2019, that increased to 4%. Whoop, whoop, right. Yet 33% of pupils in primary schools in England are Black, Asian or minority ethnic. So what does it say to our pupils that only 4% of books aimed at them contain a Black, Asian or minority ethnic protagonist, yet 36% contain an animal as the lead character? So we make sure that the books that our pupils read reflect the realities of Harper Bell, of Birmingham and of Britain in 2021. And it all comes down to this. So Black history cannot be seen as something separate to British history. It is British history, and British history is Black history. So if we're going to teach, I don't know, the Industrial Revolution, we need to be teaching our children not only about the cotton mills and cottonopolis of the north and, you know, child labour and all of that, but that the raw cotton used in the cotton mills of Lancashire came from the plantations of the Americas. We also then need to teach our children things such as in 1862, Lancashire mill worker strike during the US Civil War, and the Lancashire mill workers standing side by side with those slaves working on the plantations and refusing to use that raw cotton. Yorkshire tea, nothing against Yorkshire tea, I love a nice brew, but tea doesn't come from Yorkshire. So if we're using that as a, just to illustrate the story of Britain's imperialist footprint, you know, China, the opiate wars, India, Africa, transatlantic slave trade, the Americas and the Caribbean, all linked to tea. So we're Harper Bell. I think I managed to get that in 10 minutes. Our website and Twitter's there. We are happy to work alongside anybody and to learn from anybody. We don't know everything and we're desperate to work alongside like-minded colleagues who want to work on this topic and this subject. And kind of my last bit of our story would be, I don't know if you can see me, you can't, let me turn my camera on. Right, is this pen? So on my first day at Harper Bell 5 years ago, I opened the doors to the parents at 8:30 in the morning to be met by a parent whose words were, "Who are you?" And okay, good morning. I'm Phil Hynan, deputy head. So you're not the head. No, I'm not the head. But that's good because you're too white. Okay, right, great. That's a great start. But that same parent last week bought me a pen just out of the blue, and she's a tough old cookie, right? So to come up to me out of the blue with this pen that says, "Mr. Hynan, remain authentic," and she said she was wrong, that everything she's seen me lead and fight for and so on, she's wrong. Yeah, I wasn't too white. And my advice would be leaders who might be nervous about pushing for this sort of change because you might not know everything that you think you need to know, or you might make mistakes or could offend. Any step forward is better than standing still or going back. Yeah, I didn't know any of this. I come from an Irish Catholic family. Yeah, I can tell you loads about why my family didn't necessarily like the history of Britain in Ireland. I can sing you rebel songs until the cows come home. I didn't know about any of this and I had to teach it myself. So it's just get up, get out there and just do it. That's me.
Thank you, Philip. That's an extraordinary reminder of what schools can do if they want to.
And in terms of impact, like I said, we get children streamed through our doors because of where we're based. There's no housing where we are. We're in the city centre. So we get children who come and go who are temporarily housed in local accommodation and so on. We've gone from 20% getting combined in reading, writing and maths at the end of key stage two in 2016 to 70% in the last reported set of data. And that's despite the fact that our children come and go and come and go and come and go. Because they buy into what we're doing and because they see themselves in the curriculum.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Graham, before you go on to our next speaker, there's a lot of activity in the chat and we are going to get back to this point about how we can use the opportunities that are there in secondary as well to continue the kind of work that's going on in primary. Yeah, because that's a question that comes up all the time. Oh, we've got to stick to the syllabus. Yeah, you've got to undermine the worst excesses of the syllabus. And we've got people who have done that. So we'll be talking about that at the end. Thank you so much, Philip. Graham, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Rosemary. So our next speakers are Colin Baxter. I've just had a terrible moment. Simon Martin. Sorry, I know you, it's Simon, but I couldn't
remember. I'll let you off, Graham. It's fine.
I have known Simon and Colin for some time because I met them both when I was doing some work in Peterborough. And at one point I was asked to chair a thing called an interim executive board. Now, if you don't know what one of those is, it's not good news. A school needs one. This school also needed a head teacher and we were lucky enough to get Simon to agree to do it. And 5 years on, it is 5 years now, just about.
Coming up to 5 years, yeah.
There is a wonderful story to tell. Simon and Colin, who I also worked with, who leads on literacy and EAL across Thomas Deacon Education Trust, which Gladstone Primary Academy is now part of. I'm going to talk about some of the innovative things that they've been doing with the curriculum at Gladstone. So I'm doing your slides. I'm just going to screen share.
And while you're doing that, Graham, I'll get started then.
Yeah.
So like Graham said, we're in Peterborough. We're a large primary. We've got 600 children. We serve a very diverse community. I think we've got 6 children across the whole school who do not have another language in the home. We've got a wide range of ethnicities and cultures. We've got over 40 languages. And a real feature of the school is the changing demographic. And, you know, we see an increasing rate of Eastern European, and we believe about 25% of our school community now are actually of Roma heritage. You know, another thing that, again, has to influence our curriculum is we have really high mobility. So just over the last academic year, even given periods of lockdown, we had 105 children arrive. And, you know, the school hasn't increased its size. We've had children leave, you know, at the same rate that children arrive. So we experience this high level of churn. You know, it often means that many of our children arrive with gaps in their education and schooling. You know, I think in reality, we've been doing catch up for a long time, and that's influenced the curriculum that we do. I think it's great going third in a presentation like this, because I can see definite links with what Philip's been saying about making the curriculum in your school reflect your community. It's great to see Boy at the Back of the Class, one of the books that you had there, Philip, and that's our current whole school novel that we're reading to all classes, are reading it together at the same time. And I think I'll touch on some of the points that Meena made around cultural capital. And I think my message would be really consider your curriculum. There's the great quote, everything works somewhere, nothing works everywhere. I think it's about making sure that you review your curriculum to meet your local needs. So for us, you know, our induction has to be really tight for new children. You know, most of our children arrive, it's the first school that they've been to in the country, often with very limited or no English. So we run an induction group that lasts for no more than 8 weeks. It's about really giving that positive start to school, you know, getting used to the school routines and expectations, putting in the oracy and the phonics they need. So when they graduate after 8 weeks, they go into that, you know, wider classroom setting and they're able then to begin to access at a higher level and make that rapid approach. And we found that we have lots of children arriving with gaps in their education, and we've moved to I hesitate to call it a stage, not age approach for our English and maths, but it's an approach that's based around next steps. So identifying what the next steps are for children. And we group across year groups for English and maths. So we can have year six children and year three children working in the same maths group. And we were worried at the very beginning about whether that would mean children, you know, loss of that self-esteem, but actually what we found is those children who've been in year six and struggling with the work that was pitched, you know, higher than their ability at that point, you know, and getting demotivated by it, where they're in a group where that it's pitched at the right level, they're making the rapid progress and seeing that self-esteem rise. I think Meena touched on some, you know, use of specialist teaching, and we use a lot of specialist teaching. We have specialist teachers for art, PE, music and Spanish. We've got a Spanish speaking Spanish teacher, and we're currently national Spanish champions, but not only first place, but we've got first, second, third and fourth. And something that's come out of having a stage not age appropriate means that sometimes we have to be more creative with our curriculum, and actually if children are moving between year groups and classes, it made some of the trips difficult that you would normally do in primary. So what we do is we regroup after every 8 weeks of a cycle of English and maths to make sure that children are in the right group, you know, for the progress that they're making. So it's not a glass ceiling at all. And it gives us a week, which we call an enrichment week. And again, COVID has impacted on this. And it's a week where we don't, well, some people say we come off time to come off curriculum and time to end. It's not. We're a week away from the English and maths, a real opportunity to provide the experiences. And they're not randomly chosen. It's about giving our children some of the opportunities, that social and cultural capital that they might not have experienced before. So I think some of the pictures that you've got on your screen at the moment are just some of the activities that happened during our last enrichment week before we hit COVID. And it was really important for our, it's really important for our children, not only to have the knowledge, but also to actually have some of those experiences, those wider life experiences that knowledge sits upon. And it's not just within the school day. We approach our enrichment, our after-school enrichment, quite in an innovative way. We're one of the very few schools in the country as a primary school that we've got a cadet force, a mini cadet force, and it's not the children who you would expect who excel and really enjoy that. Sometimes the more timid and reserved children. And also we have a bilingual club, which Colin is going to talk about in more detail. So Colin, if I hand over to you, I think it's the next slide, Graham.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thank you. So just to reiterate, I'm actually based at the Thomas Deacon Education Trust, and I work closely with all of our schools in Peterborough, and Simon Martin School, Glaston Primary, is in PE1, so right in the heart of Peterborough. So although Simon's touched on most of this on the screen, it just kind of introduces the work that I'm going to share with you around the why we develop bilingual clubs as part of the enrichment offer. And you can see, I mean, that figure of 95% EAL is conservative, and it can be 100% at any one time, even if technically some families declare their child is English speaking. In the wider DfE definition, they are definitely EAL. A lot of those pupils that need to go through a significant induction program that Simon referred to are often new to English or in early stages of acquisition. So the DfE coding of A and B applies to so many of them. So the curriculum itself has had to be adapted significantly to support their induction into school. We've spoken about churn. The full panoply of pupils in the school adds up to, last time I checked, to 40 different languages being spoken. And in some cases, children will speak English and one or two or three other languages at any one time to various levels of competence. And we all know that we've got a lot of our kind of standard deprivation and disadvantage-based challenges in terms of kind of progressing outcomes towards meeting age-related expectations. And of course, the kind of wider community challenges that come with that to do with getting good family involvement, good family liaison, although we do have a really good family liaison team in place. But we definitely worked in our bilingual clubs, which I'll give detail about in a minute, to help develop that side of it. Okay, thanks, Graham.
Thank you. Sorry, next slide.
I've got two slides, sorry. So the big question that came about when I first conceptualized of bilingual clubs was the, how can we therefore help develop this school that's been on this journey that Graham referred to really maximize literacy development, knowing that's one of the keys to the whole development of the pupils in the school. And so I put my mind to thinking about the, how can we still find more quality time in terms of hours? Because I know as a, myself as a language teacher, that what you need is high quality language input in interesting and meaningful context. And if we can expand that, then we're at least giving children more of what's good for them. We also wanted to harness the fact that these pupils are bilingual or multilingual in some cases, and it wasn't really being activated. It was about coming to school and accessing the curriculum and improving your English, which of course is very important, but we were missing a trick in terms of activating the other languages that they brought. And of course, with those languages, there's a chance to celebrate their heritage, to show that the school values their heritage, and to also get them to openly bring that cultural capital that they might bring from their heritage into school. Okay, and also it was a significant opportunity to engage with parents by using the bilingual club for pick up and drop off, to actually do more listening to those parents, particularly in their home language. So rather than it just being an interface of coming to school and speaking English with the head or the class teacher, there'll be a Romanian speaker or an Urdu speaker there or a Slovak speaker there to listen to you and help build that community. And also invite the parents in to follow the club and see what happens, to learn how to do it at home. Last slide, Graham, and then I'll finish. I'm aware time is short. Okay, so just a quick outline then. So what pupils actually get is Monday to Thursday, an hour's bilingual club at the end of the day, those that have signed up. We're currently offering Romanian, Slovak and Urdu, led by some bilingual activity leaders who have a good level of English and are native speakers of those languages. We've obviously had COVID challenges, but we've built it around a mini community centre on the school grounds. So parents on a Thursday come in, they get tea, coffee, biscuits, and they join in the actual sessions with the children and the leaders. So there's a kind of a show and tell opportunity for that oracy. And they can also see how the bilingual leaders themselves actually model to them reading and using text and storytelling to help them. And so it's fundamentally storytelling, but it's oracy based. It's not about reading and writing, and it links to craft activities based on what they're doing here and now, role play, cutting things out, colouring things in, talking about what they're doing. Translanguaging is encouraged, so constantly flitting between both languages, giving equal value to them both, and just focusing on communication and social interaction. And just finally, on impact, we have been COVID hit, but we have got a method by which we actually use NASIA scales for looking at their English language proficiency, but also we're working with a charity, ICANN Talk Boost, who specialise in interventions around oracy communication skills, and we're tracking in both English and in English and in their other mother tongue what their progress is like, which I hope to be able to report on more formally next term, when we can hold on to the kids for more than a term before lockdown. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Colin and Simon. That's another inspirational example of what you can do if you don't consider yourself bound by the straitjacket of the national curriculum. There is actually lots of room for manoeuvre if you want to, and you can do all kinds of different things. So thanks again very, very much for that. It's really inspiring. Rosemary.
Fabulous, fabulous. Thank you so much, Colin and Simon. Hope you can stay with us to the end, because there's been, you know, some really good reaction in the chat to your presentation. Fabulous. I'd like to, without further ado, introduce our final speaker for this evening, and it is the wonderful Anne Palmer. Anne has been and is a successful and highly experienced veteran education leader, including 14 years of outstanding experience as a head teacher, unusually in primary and secondary. I knew her as a secondary head. She was a great supporter of the Investing in Diversity program in London, and now leads an executive leadership program for Black and other global majority educators that is second to none. If you look at the lineup of some of her tutors, it's absolutely incredible. She's a consultant and an executive coach, What she doesn't know about school improvement just ain't worth knowing. CEO of Fig Tree International, more of that later. Definitely a disruptor of deficit narratives. Anne, over to you.
I love that word disruption, Rosemary. So let me disrupt you all again this evening. Graham, if we could go straight to the slides, that would be wonderful. I'm going to try and pull some of the narrative together in the context of how you might manage this in a school, how you might manage this in a local area or a mat. So I'm coming from this in terms of a leadership perspective, and what we have done, and today is specifically about one aspect of the work, which is the race charter mark, is I've come to this with a headship experience, with the context of why we need to do this work, why we need to do it now, why it cannot remain on the back burner. Schools have gone into a very operational way of working at the moment, which is understandable with COVID and everything. But I say from the very, very beginning that this is a lived experience for staff within your schools and for children that you are working with. If we could move to the next slide, please. So in terms of what we have done, you know, there's some of the context about do BAME staff have to work twice as hard as everybody else? Probably yes. But there's also the context that, you know, there's a lot of hidden narrative. As a head, you very clearly have to be mindful that you are representative of an employer in terms of how you speak about race. There's likely to be more accusations about, you know, you, when you're adapting things in terms of diversity and race equality, about the context of why you're doing that and why you're adapting. Is it because of your colour? And that, again, that wouldn't be necessarily thrown at somebody if they were not a person of colour. But I need to just really very briefly tell you, unless you can get to the core of why people have to do this work, then it's unlikely that it's going to be successful. So if we move on to the next slide, I've got two very, very brief reasons, but they go to the heart of my practice. The first is that my first grandson was born about a year ago, and I was, you know, overjoyed, overwhelmed. As an educationalist, I was thinking, yes. And I stopped in my tracks the first time that I saw him. And you know, the conclusion was, this is a black boy growing up in the UK. What kind of an experience will he have from even before he gets to school? What experience is he going to have if he was in your classroom? What experience is he going to have in terms of his interaction with the police, in terms of the types of curriculum that he's going to be exposed to, in terms of exclusion figures, behaviour, all of those sort of things that are contextualised around what happens within a school and within the school curriculum. And I felt that there was a need, certainly, to look holistically at school practice. Of course, the second reason, which is on the next slide, is the event that just totally kicked the wind out of everybody. But for people of colour, it was dynamic. But for people of colour, it is still here today. And for people of colour, we cannot let this, the implications of what happened, sit to the side of our work. It has to be central to what we do, and we have to be discussing it with our students. And, you know, oracy has come across as a key theme throughout this evening. If we move on to the next slide. So in thinking about how this might be addressed, one of the things that I noticed, and I hope that this rings true to yourself, is that currently the model of leading anti-racism strategies tends to fit, you know, and I know that I'm generalizing, but this is generally where it sits, in that you've got some really significant people nationally and internationally that will talk diversity over and over again. They will keep throwing the data at you. They will keep sending those strong messages, but they are working as individuals. If you don't follow them on social media, if you don't read their papers, you're never going to know. You then get the individuals locally. So, you know, where you hear, oh, there's some fantastic practice in Leicester, or there's some fantastic practice in Kent. But those individuals, you have to go and seek out. And it's done largely through word of mouth, nothing else. We've got universities that have centres for race equality, they're doing some excellent work. But again, unless you are in that arena to look for the work there, you're not going to find it. We saw some excellent examples of books and literature today, but what percentage of schools actually reorder books or work with their libraries to make sure that diversity is in there? Individual schools, got some fabulous schools on here today that have developed their curriculum. And certainly, you know, everybody's wanting to know now, how do you do it? How can we develop that work? But again, how many people are going to have access to the knowledge that you're having access to this evening? We've got individual consultants. Again, since all of this, and I say all of this quite liberally, some of these consultants have never been trained. It's highly likely that they're going to have to be people of colour, because they want to respond, but they don't. Some of them don't know how. So rather than being proactive, they're being reactionary. Local authorities, we know at least two or three that are really racing forward with this agenda. It's an important to follow what they are doing. Haringey is one particularly. Lewisham is having issues at the moment because of the data in relation to non-white students. And lastly, in terms of online organisations, such as BayMed, all of those organisations that you know are there for people to go and look for the resources that they need. If we move on to the next slide, so what are these different facets doing? Where's the coordination? Well, we find that they're running leadership courses. And the problem with this is that leaders move to different schools. Leaders do courses for their own reasons. What is the longevity of the model? We have courses that focus entirely on reforming, revamping the curriculum, which is an absolute necessity. And again, who are you working with? Are you working with all your curriculum leaders, or are you working with the deputy head who is in charge overall of curriculum? Who are you working with? Bespoke training, you know, I get a lot, and I'm sure a lot of people do, people saying to me, can you come and do some unconscious bias training? Well, I say, no, I can't. You know, give it a context, because it's all very well people feeling fine about this agenda for an hour, but this goes deeper than that, and we need to acknowledge that. University courses, people going to do PhD, masters and so forth. Online learning resources, which we can signpost, absolutely excellent. And, you know, toolkits, let me just tick to see if we're doing this right. Let me just tick a box. Is that developmental? Is it sustainable? Is it emotive? Is it action-based? And the last one I've got there is about D&E leadership courses. Well, these are brilliant again, but what you get is one person with the knowledge then having to convince an organisation that this is the right thing to do. So having thought about how diversity and inclusion looks at the moment, if we move on to the next slide, I worked very closely with the Specialist Schools and Academies Trust, who I'm sure you all know. And we have developed the Race and Conscious Charter Mark. And it's effectively an award that recognises where schools have absolutely phenomenal practice in terms of their approach to race equality. And if we move on to the next slide, just very, very briefly, I'm going to touch on what the content is of the Race Charter Mark. And there's more information available on my website. And I've also got a spelling mistake that I spotted. But let's go with this very, very briefly. Within the Race Charter Mark, you have the view that in order for the work to be sustainable, it has to start with governance. It has to involve senior leaders. It has to involve middle leaders. So within the Charter Mark, you actually have three lots of training, including We talk with your governors, we talk with governors about their statutory responsibilities, about what data might look like in their school, how they themselves need to be monitoring diversity issues and so forth. And part of that, we use the Race at Work Charter. The Race at Work Charter is run by business in the community. Business in the community have over 500 organisations that have signed to their charter that says, for over 20 years, we have been looking at best practice, not just in education, but right across the spectrum. So within the charter mark, you will see best practice that is directly proven to have absolute results. Assessing equality, we look at data, we look at policies, we look at vision, we take senior leaders through the process. And you know, there's nothing, for me, what I say to the leaders is, if you are doing parental engagement, you know, that has got to be equality impact assessed, because how do you know what parents are taking part, what parents are accessing the work, what parents are having as outcomes? So the whole leadership team is involved in assessing what's going on. Leadership and management, which talks about vision and other parts that are unique. Conscious curriculum. We have our approach to this, but certainly what we've heard today is absolutely phenomenal. And schools are calling out. But what we ask our leaders today, we say every single lesson that you plan, you need to be conscious of your own biases. You need to be conscious of the role models that you're using. You know, in terms of classroom environment, if we were to do a learning walk, what's going to be on your walls? Are there going to be any people of colour located? When you put your whiteboard presentations up, are there any people of colour presented within that? There's a lot more in all of these aspects that I'm talking about, but I'm just very quickly just touching on some of the content. The next one is professional development. Which staff are being promoted in your school? Who is having access to courses? How many staff are being retained? How many staff of colour are being retained? If you look at your senior leadership team, are there any people of colour? If there aren't, why not? And stakeholder engagement goes to looking outwards of the school, engaging parents and the community. So why the charter mark works? We start with moral purpose. People have to know why the work needs to be done. We support it with training. And it isn't one-off training. It's training that engages the whole school on a continual basis. But we also recognise that schools are unique in their context. So we deal with schools that have aroma intake, for instance. We have partnerships, if I could spell that correctly, that actually will work with that school in order to address their individual needs. This works because it's ongoing action. They write an action plan that says, this is what we're doing now, but actually over the next 1, 2, 3 years, we are going to continue to look at race equality as an area of significance in our work. And what we say to them finally on this point is that once you get this right in one area of the protected characteristics, then it's very easy to transfer that thinking and way of working when we move on to the others. If we move on to the final slide, I think it is. So we train, we ask schools to an action plan of their current work, but also what they aim to do in the future. If they don't do this in the future, they will lose the award. It's as serious as that. So people do not undertake this if they're not serious about this area of work. They submit that, and then that is assessed by Fig Tree and the SSAT. Last slide. Okay, so Rosemary's asked me to say, you know, what do I really think that when you look at this holistically, what leaders should be focusing? First of all, take a long-term organisational system-wide approach. Not just a short-term, what are we going to do this year? Secondly, people need to know the why. You promote emotional intelligence, you get them to explore that. You then allow them to do short-term targets and their longer-term actions, and there has to be longer-term actions. We say although one person is in charge of the charter mark, everybody is a stakeholder. And the last thing, you hold people to account to ensure that they do it. And finally, on the last slide, I keep calling it last slide, which is the last slide. My key message really is that if the system isn't going to change, and we've had some comments in the chat about all of this good work seems to stop in secondary. But then if the system won't change, we change the system. We start from where we are with local heads, with local authorities, and we just do what we need to do. And when I say we, I mean every person as an individual, as a group. We can't sit by and say, oh, somebody else is doing this, therefore. Everybody has a role to play. So I know I've gone through that really quickly. I hope that gives you a sense of where we are. I've got my contact details on the last page. There's lots of information on the website about the charter mark, but looking at one area, it's much better to kind of think holistically, how is this going to look within an organization as we move forward?
Oh, thank you so very much, Anne. That was absolutely fabulous. I think people will agree. Just give, you know, round of applause wherever you are. You know, Anne just pulled together, as she said she would, that strategic overview that is needed. And I like the way that she began by placing herself in the midst of this. Why are you involved in this work? You know, that's the first why that any leader and anybody needs to engage with in terms of taking this work further. And then I like the way that she ended. Strategic. We have to operate strategically across the piece to actually shift the dial. And that strategy doesn't come from policies from the DfE or Ofsted or anywhere else. It actually comes from practitioners on the ground looking holistically at how we move things forward. And there's enough experience in the system and enough good practice, the sort of thing that The Guardian doesn't write about. There's enough of that in the system for us to begin to acknowledge what it is that we need to do to create safe passage. I kind of see it as a kind of underground to Canada movement. Create safe passage for all students through this system so that they come through the other end. And, you know, as we hope for Anne's grandchild, that they are then a citizen who, you know, can take part fully in what this wonderful world has to offer. So Anne, thank you so much. I'm gonna hand back to Graham and we'll see whether we have some time for questions, but Graham, we could have had any one of these speakers tonight. We could have just run a masterclass. You know, we could have just had them, couldn't we? Running their own masterclass in terms of what needs to be done. I think it's been absolutely fabulous. I'm sitting here like Tigger. Graham, over to you.
We like to have time for questions. I think the truth is we've had such five fantastic speakers that it was much more useful to give them more time than to have lots of time for questions. Now, I'm just having a look to see what questions there are in the chat. And I think what there is, there's a fairly specific one about what was happening at Gladstone that we can get a direct answer to rather than go to that now. But mostly what I see in the chats is people saying, amazing, fantastic, brilliant. And that's very heartening. When you put something like this together, you want it to make a difference, you want it to inspire people. And I think that's what all of our speakers have done tonight. So thank you very much to all of them. If we can give them all a bit of a clap, because I think they've been brilliant. Yes, someone's just said this session's too short. It needs to be 2 hours.
I keep telling him, you know, I keep telling Philip that, sorry, Graham, that we need to move to 2 hour slots. I mean, I haven't discussed this with Graham, but I think that what would be really nice is if we have seminars like this, that we then have a kind of round table discussion, you know, so that there's a format where you get the fabulous presentations, and then probably we have a little bit of a break, and then we go to round table discussions where we can actually get into the meat of some of that. I mean, if people think that's a good idea, do let Graham and I know. And I think, Graham, that might be a way to go.
Yeah. And so we've now done three of these. We didn't know if there was going to be a second one when we started, but there is. We're already starting to think about the fourth one. And maybe we'll do that one that way. I think that would be great. Okay, so I think we're now going to call it to a close. That doesn't mean the end, because we're going to send you the recording, we're going to send you all of the PowerPoints, and where there's a question that hasn't been answered, we're going to send you an answer to the question as well. And we want to stay in touch, because these are important conversations, and there aren't too many other people having them at the moment in this way. And if you know of anyone else who is, put us in touch with them, because we'd love to join up. So I'm going to press the stop button for the recording, and then we're going to close the meeting. If the presenters could hang on for a bit, because just one, two things we need to say to them, other than our very public thank you. So thank you all very much indeed.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Meena. Thank you, Simon. Thank you, Philip. Thank you, Colin. Thank you, Anne. Absolutely fabulous. And thank you, all of you guys. Fiona's been really, really active in the chat. See you there, Fiona, you know. Catherine as well. There's been a lot of people. Nikki Gill, thank you so much for being active. And yeah, we're going to change up the format so that you guys actually, we sit around. I can envision a table that we all sit around, and we then break bread and discuss. Yes? So thank you so much. God bless.